On the eve of our Independence Day, I greet my fellow citizens in India and abroad and offer them my sincere good wishes for their well-being and prosperity. Let us, on this day, respectfully pay our humble homage to the millions of known and unknown soldiers, men and women, who, without expectation of any reward, gave their all, many of them even their lives, at the altar of freedom, under the inspiring and noble leadership of Mahatma Gandhi, the father of the nation. These martyrs did their duty by the country. It was left to us to translate this political freedom into practical terms.
This is only a radio archives recording.
We enshrined in our constitution certain basic rights as being fundamental for securing the right to live and the right to work, so as to ensure to every citizen a decent standard of life. This shall be the last occasion for me to address the nation as the President of India. I would like to take the opportunity to express my deep sense of gratitude for the goodwill and affection that the people have bestowed on me in such abundance. I am first and foremost a servant of the people. As President, I have been conscious of the constraints imposed upon the occupant of this high office by the Constitution in the discharge of his functions. But even within these limits, I have striven in my own humble way to place before the nation certain ideas from time to time in the belief that they would help in finding solutions to some of the difficult problems facing the nation. A vast country like India, with a population of over 570 million, is bound to have continuing problems concerning the social well-being and economic prosperity of her people. The question that we have to ask ourselves is how far we have gone and how much we have achieved in real and tangible terms during these 27 years of independence. Poverty, unemployment, lack of enough food, clothing and shelter, malnutrition and disease have persisted with us all these years. The country had to face ravages of nature such as drought, floods, etc. at frequent intervals. Added to these are the man-made evils of corruption, inflation and movements that disrupt the normal life, obstructing production by bonds and other activities aimed at thwarting democratic processes.
This is it is my firm belief
that the only durable solution to the challenges of poverty and unemployment in India lies in purposeful development of rural India. While we talk about planning from the grassroots level, the measures to translate this idea into action have been halting and tardy. There has to be a massive program of settling village communities on land. Every inch of land that is available should be utilized to secure maximum agricultural production. Cottage and agro industries suited to different areas should be organized on as wide a scale as practicable. Such a program, I have consistently pointed out, will provide full employment to both men and women in the rural areas and will be the surest foundation for building a self-generating economy. It will also ensure, at the same time, vastly increased food production, our country's first priority. A country like ours, whose predominant resource is agriculture, has no justification to have to depend on imports to feed its population adequately. Our agricultural scientists are among the best in the world and are capable of devising methods of improved cultivation, even providing against the vagaries of weather. What is needed is a long-term political and budgetary commitment to achieve the goal of self-sufficiency and ensure sustained growth. A necessary corollary to this will be the direct involvement of the farmers in agricultural policy decisions. In the matter of production and distribution of food, there is no room for political bargaining among the states or between the center and the states. The whole country has to be treated as one unit, and the central government, in close coordination with the states, should take upon itself the responsibility to see that there is equitable distribution throughout the country. There is no reason why an efficient and adequate public distribution system covering not only food grains but also other essential commodities for daily consumption cannot be built up. This alone will bring down prices to reasonable levels and act as the most effective weapon against unhealthy trade practices. The hoarders and black marketers are not unknown quantities. If there is a vigilant public opinion and a determined political will, these anti-social operations can be totally eliminated. It has been a most regrettable development in recent years that money power has come to play such a dominant role in the elections to the legislatures. This, to my mind, is at the root of corruption and corruptive influences in our public life. People may lose faith in cherished democratic values if leaders of all political parties do not take prompt corrective measures to remedy the situation by joint consultations. Adult franchise, when it is exercised freely and without fear, is the best guarantee for responsive and responsible government. We chose the parliamentary system and through it responsible government as the best suited to the genius of our people and as the most effective instrument of achieving desired goals. Nation building involves wholehearted cooperation of all sections of the people. The state must also create conditions in which such cooperation will be forthcoming willingly. Provision of minimum comforts and basic amenities of life is the birthright of every citizen. Equally, every citizen, to whatever walk of life he may belong, must do his duty by the state so that we may progress as a nation built on firm and strong foundations. I would make a special appeal here to my working class comrades in the farms
this is
and in the factories
archives recording.
To take a pledge on this solemn occasion that they will do nothing that will hamper greater production. The right to strike and the right to impose lockouts are extreme weapons and should never be exercised except as a last resort when all channels of negotiation are exhausted. When the country is passing through an economic crisis, a strike or lockout, whether in industry or in transport or in any essential service, will be counterproductive and self-defeating. Inflation and high prices can be fought effectively only by uninterrupted growth of production, more particularly of food grains and other commodities essential for the daily life of the community. While some of the steps recently taken to limit spending may help in checking inflation to an extent, it is necessary to take complementary steps to hold the price line and ensure a clean and honest distribution system. Black money, of which so much is talked about, must be put out of circulation by stern measures. While industry should be allowed to grow freely by sound investment for the common good through well-regulated channels, investment in luxuries and non-essentials must be curbed severely. The administration has the primary duty here to see that its laws are enforced and action taken against the offenders without fear or favor. The corrupt and the inefficient should be weeded out without mercy, as much as the dishonest businessman or trader is punished promptly and stringently. The energy crisis, which today is a world phenomenon, has had its inevitable impact on our economy. This has made it all the more necessary for us to enforce discipline both in our spending power and in channeling of resources. We have made steady progress in scientific and technological development. The recent successful experiment by our scientists in the nuclear explosion is no mean achievement. By tradition and temperament, we are a peaceful nation. Our own conduct in the past, in conflicts into which we were forced, has demonstrated to the world our commitment to peaceful settlement of disputes. In pursuing the recent experiment, we are not competing for a place among nuclear powers. Ours is a solemn affirmation that the nuclear technology that we develop will be used entirely in the interests of the progress of man. In my visits to a large number of countries abroad during my 5-year tenure as president, I have found the most abundant goodwill and esteem from the people of those countries towards India. We look upon this goodwill and friendly relations as an asset of lasting value. The Constitution and the laws have their due place in the conduct of the affairs of any civilized society. But what makes a country a respected member of the Committee of Nations is the character of its people and those who govern them. We have been fortunate in keeping India together as a stable democracy all these years. We have still a long way to go and hard work to do to provide minimum comforts and basic amenities to every citizen so that he or she may lead a decent life appropriately. I would like to recall here the words spoken by Jawaharlal Nehru in the Constituent Assembly on the midnight of August 15, 1947, on the occasion of ushering in independence. The service of India means the service of the millions who suffer. It means the ending of poverty and ignorance and disease and inequality of opportunity. The ambition of the greatest man of our generation has been to wipe every tear from every eye. That may be beyond us, but as long as there are tears and suffering, so long our work will not be over. Let us all rededicate ourselves to serve India to the best of our ability. Jai Hind!